Good afternoon. I'd like to welcome you all and thank you for being here. My name is Maxim Shrayer, and I have the pleasure of directing the project on Russian and Eurasian Jewry here at the Davis Center. I know some of you have attended our events in the past, but I just want to give you a very brief history. Last year, we launched the project with the generous support of Genesis Philanthropy Group, and we are now in our second year. And this year, and I just want to say this before I introduced our very wonderful speakers, this year we're doing something different. We're doing a series of panels, conversations that focus on great Russian Jews who changed the world. And specifically, we are exploring various intersections of main lines of Russian, Soviet, and Jewish history. And the figures we are focusing on, starting with the great Golda Meir, are such incredible figures that are equally important to a number of histories and traditions. And in November, we'll have an event on Vasily Grossman, the great writer and witness to the Shoah. And then in the spring, we'll have two events, one on David Oistrakh, the great violinist and teacher of many great virtuosi, and Botvinnik, the great Jewish-Soviet chess player and world who dominated the chess scene for several decades and trained many, many chess champions, many of them Russian Jews. So that's what we have ahead of us. And again, I want to acknowledge Genesis Philanthropy Group and also all my colleagues here at the Davis Center, especially Sarah Filer, who did a lot of publicity and designed our website, which you can visit, and it advertises all our events and features the information about the speakers. So without further ado, let me just say that I'm so pleased to welcome Pnina, Lahav, and Sam Kassow to our panel on Golda Meir. I'll briefly introduce them, and then we'll delve into this conversation, after which we'll have some time for questions. So do save your questions, please. Pnina Lahav, the Israeli-born scholar and author who comes to us from BU, but from Israel by way of BU, I should say, is a professor of law and a member of the faculty of the Elie Wiesel Center for Judaic Studies at Boston University. Her fields of expertise are constitutional law, First Amendment law, and legal history. She is the recipient of many awards, prizes, and distinguished fellowships, most recently the Israel Studies Award for Lifetime Achievement and the Boston University School of Law Silver Shingle Award. She is the author of numerous publications, including the acclaimed judicial biography, Justice in Jerusalem, Chief Justice Simon Agranat. And this, by the way, is directly relevant to today's story, as you will here later this afternoon. And of late, Professor Lahav has focused her attention on the status and history of women and is presently completing the biography of Golda Meir, Israel's fourth prime minister, through the gender lens. Samuel Kassow, who comes to us from Connecticut by way of a number of East European and Central European countries, born to Holocaust survivors in a displaced camp in Germany, is Charles Northam Professor of History at Trinity College. In 2006-2012, he was a lead historian for two of the galleries of Polin, the Museum of the History of Polish Jews in Warsaw. If some of you have been there, I'm sure you know what a incredible museum it is, and I personally so much appreciate Sam's contribution to it. He has received the National Endowment for the Humanities, Fulbright, Woodrow Wilson, and Danforth Fellowship, and has been elected a Fellow of the American Academy of Jewish Research. Kassow's many publications include Student Professors and the State in Tsarist Russia, The Distinctive Life of East European Jewry, and probably his best-known book, Who Will Write Our History? Emmanuel Ringelblum and the Secret Ghetto Archive, which has been translated into many languages, 8 or 9? 8 languages, and also a documentary film was based on it. So welcome, and thank you so much for being here. And I'd like to begin by posing both of you the same question. Pnina, let's start with you. Why Golda Meir and why now? Other than the fact that it's a convenient double anniversary.
Exactly. So first of all, it's a good idea to talk about one of Israel's major leaders and politicians. We always talk about men. You know, somebody here mentioned Shimon Peres. You can talk about Ben-Gurion. You can talk about Bibi Netanyahu. But we also had a few women. And we had this woman who was actually quite central, and it's time for us to value it.
Beautiful.
Value her, understand what she did.
Perfect. Sam,
value it and also criticize it, but at least, you know, take stock of what she did.
I'm vastly uncritical, as
yes.
you know. Sam, why Golda Meir and now?
Because she played a major role, not just in the history of Israel, but I would say in Jewish history in the 20th century. And she had this incredible ability. She was this atypical and at the same time very striking individual who was able to link through her activities three of the major focal points of Jewish life in the last century: Russia and the East European Jewry of the Pale, American Jewry, and Palestine, which becomes the State of Israel. And she was able to bring all that together in a way that nobody else could have.
Yeah.
Perfect.
So can I just have a follow up to that? I think that's very, very true. But what I want to add to that is she arrived in Palestine in 1920. So, which is generally on the cusp of the second Aliyah and the third Aliyah. And the second Aliyah was the legendary Aliyah of those founders of Israel and the ideologues of Zionism, those who founded the kibbutzim. So she actually became one of them. So she could always claim, as a matter of identity, that she was a founder, a member of the second Aliyah. That was a very important part of her identity.
Wonderful. By the way, I just want to acknowledge that Pnina prepared this wonderful presentation, which has some photographs which we'll show. But I want to begin by playing a very short clip from the 1982 film, A Woman Called Golda. I don't know if you remember, but it's the one in which Ingrid Bergman played Golda Meir, and just play a little clip. The reason I want to play this clip is because it addresses the questions of Golda Meir's Russian past and how she later presented it, perhaps mythologized it. So if the equipment works, and I hope it will, we'll just see this little clip.
I have tried to think how to express my feelings on coming to my old school. Where? As I look around, nothing seems to have changed, except me. What comes to my mind is the saying, if I am not for myself, then who will be for me? But if I am for myself only, then what am I?
Mrs. Meir, how come you left?
Left what?
America. Why did you leave America and go to Israel?
Believe me, if I had been born in America, I'm sure I never would have left. But my earliest experiences were very different from that of an American child. You see, I was born in Russia.
Why is Papa doing this?
Shh, be quiet.
What's that yelling out there, Shayna?
They say we killed their lord.
Put the lamps out!
And that's where I mainly wanted us to begin, the idea that this is a scene in which Golda Meir returned to her school in Milwaukee, right, and is speaking to school children. And what she emphasizes is that she had a very different childhood, and she says that she was born in Russia. So perhaps we could speak about her Russian beginnings. She was born in Kiev. Her father left for New York, and the family moved to Pinsk, which is in Belarus. And Sam, maybe you could tell us, well, this pogrom scene, how much truth there is historically? Is she mythologizing it? What do we make of that brief Russian childhood?
Well, I, as far as I know, I don't think she actually experienced a pogrom, but she certainly had good reason to fear one. The wave of pogroms made everybody very scared, especially the wave of pogroms beginning in 1903. Culminating in 1906. So she would have absorbed the fear, and she might have believed that she actually experienced that sense that it's going to happen at any time. The formative years of her childhood, I think, were in Pinsk, which did not see a pogrom.
Exactly. That's, yeah. As you know, of course, as her biographer, Pnina, the anti-Jewish violence in Pinsk does not occur until the Civil War, the pogroms of 1919, 1920. And so, and she would have left Kiev by the time there would have been some anti-Jewish violence. So how she is presenting it is probably a matter of very deliberate choice.
Yes, absolutely deliberate choice. So let me say, can we hear more from you, Sam, about this? Or?
Oh, you can.
Yeah. So she was born in Kiev and moved to Pinsk when she was 3 years old, when her father went to the United States. And actually, the family was from Pinsk, not from Kiev. They came to Kiev because her father was a carpenter, and he got a permit to work in Kiev, and that's how they moved to Kiev. So that's also important to understand. But the history of the Zionist ideology presents the pogrom as a cause and effect. Why is it that Jews cannot live abroad? Certainly not in Eastern Europe, okay? Because of the pogroms, okay? So she had this incident with a pogrom, and she could, you know, work it into her biography as a Zionist justification for living and feeling safer in, you know, a state of our own, if you wish. So
Perfect.
That's what she did.
Perfect. But what?
Let me just add something here. That you know, there's kind of a tennis ball going back and forth among Jewish historians, specialists in East European Jewish history. There used to be the received wisdom that the pogroms were a big turning point. 1881 was a big turning point in Jewish history. Shimon Dubnov and even Jonathan Frankel. And then you had a reaction to that. It wasn't such a turning point. And besides, the pogroms weren't that central. It was the economic issues. But American Jews put pogroms front and center in their consciousness. But now I think it would be worth at least revisiting the Zionist narrative, because even though it's fashionable today among specialists to question the Zionist narrative of East European Jewry, the fact is that those places that avoided pogroms in 1905 or 1903 very often got them with multiple force in 1919, 1920.
At which point she was already on her way to Palestine.
So even if pogroms didn't happen, the fear of pogroms was very legitimate.
Right, absolutely. But Pnina,
to say that growing up in Israel, I also heard a great deal about the pogroms and what they do and why is it that we are in Israel, among other things, because of the pogroms. So it's not only in the United States, we also got a great deal of it, yeah.
So before we get to Milwaukee,
yes,
let's just acknowledge that what Pinsk did have, and that's well documented, is it had a very strong Bundist organization, and it also had a very strong Poalition organization. And so perhaps we could sort of start speaking about her Russian beginnings and then her youth in Milwaukee in connection with those forces. In other words, these are forces of Zionism, these are forces
Pinsk, you mean now, not in Kiev.
But also later forces of the Jewish labor movement, right?
Absolutely.
And of specifically this interesting blend of socialism and labor movement. So, okay, we're in Milwaukee.
Yeah.
And can I just say something about Pinsk? You know, I think it's important to remember that Pinsk is an example of Jewish geography. Jewishly speaking, Pinsk was in Volyn, but it was also Jewish Lithuania. It was Jewish Lithuania, the Yiddish, the attitudes, the customs. And as Moshe Mishkinsky points out, it was Jewish Lithuania that was really the incubator of separate Jewish political movements in Eastern Europe. One, the Bund, and also labor Zionism, as you point out. But also Jews there, unless they were very wealthy, like Chaim Weizmann, had very little opportunity to become acculturated. Golda Meir never spoke Russian. I mean, even the Vilna Jewish intelligentsia, Tzemach Shabbat, Vygotsky, even as they spoke Yiddish in public life, they were Russian-speaking at home. But it was that milieu that really formed Jewish Jews, who were not just non-assimilated, they were non-acculturated. And Golda Meir was old enough to have grown up in that culture long enough to have been stamped by it.
That's very good.
This is very true, and she didn't go to school either, you know, so until she was 8 years old, so long as she was in Pinsk, she did not go to school because there was no money to send her to school.
So now, Pnina, give us some context of the Milwaukee childhood. Before she goes to Denver to live with her married sister, where there is something of a Jewish intelligentsia environment, let's talk about the Milwaukee period.
Yeah, so the Milwaukee period begins, in a very poor neighborhood. And finally she manages to, this was the first time in her life that she goes to school because, you know, that was mandatory in the state of Wisconsin, which, as we know, was a very progressive state, so that also affected her. And they were extremely poor. They lived in the ghetto, the Jewish ghetto in Milwaukee. And actually, the tragedy of her life was that at the time, as a young child, is that her parents did not value education. They did not value, so generally we say Jews, you know, are always, you know, so intense about their children acquiring education. They want you to be a doctor or a lawyer. They didn't want a doctor. They didn't want a lawyer. They wanted their three daughters to get married. That's all. To a good guy. That is somebody slightly above their station and not a greenhorn. That was very important to her mother, Bluma. The person will not be a greenhorn. And one of the things that her mother did, because they did not value education, her mother opened a little store in their home, a grocery store, because the father was a carpenter but did not really make a living. So they needed to do something about it. And she took over, the mother. And the mother would have to get up early in the morning, take the bus, go to the market, buy produce, and come back. And who's going to mind the store from early in the morning until she returns? The father said, this is woman's work, so he's not going to do it. The older sister, who was a socialist and a revolutionary, she was 9 years old. Older.
Who was in this little clip? Shaina. I don't know if you saw. She was Shaina, the older
the big,
girl.
The big Shaina. Sister. She had a great, great influence on Golda. Yeah. She would not do it because this was bourgeois work, so she wouldn't do it. And so it fell to Golda to do it. Golda was 8 years old, and she had to get up in the morning and open the store rather than go to school. And as she says in her memoirs, it was the bale of her life. She was so much anxious to go to school. And her mother said to her, so you will not be a rebbetzin, you know. Big deal. So, but eventually the state intervened, and somebody from the Department of Education came and informed the mother that actually in Wisconsin, children have to go to school. And she started going to school. So that's a long story, and I will just jump to, as she finished elementary school quite well, she did very well, her parents did not want her to go to high school. They wanted her to get married. She was 14, they found someone, Mr. Goodwin,
I think we're still here.
And they wanted her to get married.
Yes.
And And she didn't want to get married. So eventually she was negotiating or corresponding with her sister. Her sister had tuberculosis. So she was sent to Denver by the Jewish community to be to spend time at the hospital there.
For reasons of climate.
Yes, exactly. But it's I just, you know, a great, you know, hooray to the Jewish community that established this hospital in Denver for sick, poor Jews. So in any event, the sister planned the entire running away to Denver, okay? The sister told her how to do it, and we can talk about that if you want the details. It's actually quite interesting, because what the sister did is she employed skills that she learned at the Russian underground in Pinsk.
In getting her out
in order
of,
to help Golda leave home in Denver and come to, and leave home in Milwaukee and come to Denver. So she comes to Denver, she spends, you know, a few months in high school, and then actually she leaves high school for whatever reason. And eventually she spends some time with her sister, then she gets a big fight with her sister, she leaves, slams the door, goes away, and eventually she comes back home.
Good. So let's dwell a little bit.
I have a question about the sister.
Yes.
We don't know as much about the sister as we'd like to know, because in many ways the sister, Shaina, acts like a typical Russian intelligent.
Exactly.
The kind of young person who's read Chernyshevsky, Shtadyelets, who is modeling her life on the notion of total integrity, total principialness. Everything she does, no compromises. Did she read Russian literature? Did she know Russian? Was she the conduit of this Russian intelligentsia culture to Golda?
Absolutely. I think it's a great question. And she did. She how she did it, it's not, you know, how she came about it is actually is a mystery. Well, here was a girl. Go ahead.
I think the language in which she reads Russian literature, honestly, is practically immaterial at this point, because there were cheap Yiddish paperbacks of the Russian classics
widely
available.
There were no books
available.
In the house.
So
we don't know if they were available then. They were available later.
Yeah. But she did
in the 1920s.
Yeah. But we're talking about
when
they were already in Russia.
Right.
Yes.
No, that, yeah, okay.
So in any event, she, the interesting thing about her, Shaina, who in the United States, she was assigned the name Jenny. And for a long time, she was signing her letters Jenny. And Golda got the name Goldie. And actually, for a very long time, she was called Goldie rather than Golda. She returned to Golda when she arrived in Palestine. Shaina met a woman, a middle-class woman, in Kiev. Her mother was nursing the baby of that woman. The woman was very generous to the family, to Golda's family, and they taught Shaina Russian. So Shaina, unlike Golda, who was actually illiterate because they did not send her to school, Shaina learned Russian, and she could speak Russian. So that was very interesting because Golda never knew Russian, and therefore when they appointed her emissary to Moscow, she said, why do I have to go to Moscow? I don't even know Russian.
No, this is actually a fascinating point.
Yes.
And we will we'll get to Moscow very soon. But before we get to Moscow, let's just talk a little bit about Golda Meir's becoming interested in Zionism, becoming interested in the women's movement, and becoming interested in labor socialism and these intersections. I think in Denver, she's exposed to these things, in part because her sister and her husband was, as you were just saying, Sam, sort of Jewish intelligentsia, or perhaps on their way.
Yeah.
And I'm interested in that context. Sort of when is Golda Meir sensing sort of that's her calling?
Well, it seems to me that an important turning point, an important point of inflection is the politicization of World War I, the preparations for the American Jewish Congress, the elections, the idea that a new world is being built. You have the Russian Revolution, you have the Balfour Declaration, You have the Versailles Treaty, and Jews all over the United States are being urged to throw themselves into an election campaign to elect delegates to a Jewish Congress. The American Jewish Committee reluctantly gives in. There's a united Jewish delegation to Versailles. And because Golda, by this time she's gone back to Milwaukee, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes.
She's not in New York. She's not in a huge Jewish community. So she can make a difference. If she's a good speaker, everybody's going to notice her. And her father saw her speaking on the street, and he came to reprimand her, and he was really blown away. And she developed more confidence in her own abilities.
Yeah, that is very true. So in Denver, Shana, who was a member of the intelligentsia, Jewish intelligentsia, she and her husband were holding a salon in their apartment of either Jewish intelligence, other Jewish, you know, members of the intelligentsia. So they would come to her house, and they would talk about things that absolutely flabbergasted Golda. She never heard, you know, the you know, about the anarchists and about you know, about political events and what is going on in Russia, what about the president of the United States. Issues that really interested her, and she was just sitting there. She was 14 years old and just listening. And she absorbed a great deal. And that actually was the moment when her intellectual interest was ignited and her interest in politics was ignited. That was the moment. This was the, you know, the incubator that prepared her for her next move.
Good. So also she meets her future husband, Morris. Of course, Meirson is not her maiden name. That's the name of the man she marries, Morris Meirson.
Yes.
Later, it's Hebrewized for various reasons, which happened in Israel with many, many Jews from Eastern Europe, right, in the early 50s, mid-50s, they Hebrewized their names.
Ben-Gurion, who
this
who
happened
made her do
to it. My family, because all the Shrayers became Shrayers overnight,
yes.
Literally,
that's right.
You
yeah.
know, which is fascinating.
Yeah.
Yeah. But they are contemplating moving to Ottoman Palestine, but it doesn't happen until 1920, correct?
Yes.
I'm curious. They applied to be on the kibbutz,
yes.
Right? Kibbutz Merchavia. Why were they rejected at first? Apparently, there was something that didn't work out.
Well, they were rejected because the members of the kibbutz, the committee, the admissions committee, felt that you know, these are Americans, and therefore they must be lazy.
Uh-huh.
This was mostly Russian Jews, you know. They must be soft. They must be lazy. And therefore, you know, they don't want them there. Particularly the girl, they said the girls, American girls, you know, this American Jewish princess, they're not going to do work. And this was a very small kibbutz that really depend on hard labor. They were not interested. And she actually then did not take no for an answer. And she took the bus again and traveled there, which was many hours of travel at the time. And she persuaded them to accept her. First to give her just a chance, and then they liked her. She did a good job.
Yeah, so she's in Israel, I mean, in the British Mandate.
Yes. Yeah.
When does her political career start? What do you both think?
Her career starts exactly in the kibbutz.
Okay.
So she comes to the kibbutz, she doesn't know Hebrew, because she didn't know about this tension in Zionism. That's very interesting too, between Yiddish and Hebrew. She just didn't know about it. So she thought she would come to Palestine and speak Yiddish. So she comes to Palestine, she doesn't know Hebrew, and they give her a special permission to go to the second annual meeting of Mapai, the Labor Party, in 1921. To give a speech there, to attend it, I don't know. In any event, she goes there, she gives a speech in Yiddish, and the founders, including Ben-Gurion, look at this young woman, and they say to themselves, what's really fascinating, first of all, she's a great speaker, but she speaks English. So they can use her when she goes to the United States, if she goes to send her to the United States, to do fundraising.
So she is sent to the United States in 1931, right?
Yes. Many times. She was sent to the United States first in 1927, but yeah.
And then another
spent a lot of time in the United States.
Yes, yeah. And this is when her marriage begins.
At great personal sacrifice. And her children were born, 23 and 24, 25.
Yeah, I think 24 and 27.
But she didn't. She left her children for months at a time.
Exactly.
And her daughter was misdiagnosed with a kidney disease, very, very sick, and she left her sick child to the care of Shana and to the care of her husband while she was going around the United States. And she felt very guilty about it, but she didn't change her mind. She put her politics ahead of staying at home and taking care of her family, and she was determined to do that.
So her career is on the rise within the ranks of the General Organization of Workers
in
Israel, right? And I'm just curious, she is an observer at the Evian Conference, correct?
Yes.
Apparently, it was a very, well, obviously, one doesn't need to belabor the point that it would have been a terribly frustrating experience. But specifically, how does she, what does she get out of it when she returns to Israel?
The cynicism of the, you know, the great powers about Jews, how nobody cares for Jews. That stayed with her, you know, it was with her before, but that stayed with her until the end of their life, that actually the world doesn't care.
I just want to throw out for consideration that, again, you know, with so much of Golda Meir's life, she makes critical choices that are fashioned by the particular circumstances, which is a truism. But the particular choice that she made in those circumstances from the time she came to Palestine was she saw and she began to see ever more clearly what she believed to be the central role of the Labor Party establishment, and the Labor Party establishment not in the anachronistic sense of 1965, 1970, but as the labor establishment itself was crystallizing with Ben-Gurion and with Katz Nelson, and you had a left-wing opposing it, you had the left Politzion, you had faction B and so on. But she understood, and I don't think it was only for opportunistic reasons, although some people would say so, but she saw Ben-Gurion's role very early, and maybe for opportunistic reasons, maybe not, but she was convinced that it was Ben-Gurion strategy that was the only viable strategy to build the state, not liberalism, not Weizmann, not Tel Aviv, not the urban route, even though most Jews did not live in the kibbutzim. Mm. And she really believed this, but this was her ladder to success. You know, first in the pioneer women, but then Ben-Gurion understood that she wasn't just a delegate to the pioneer women.
Yeah, that is all true. But we also have to take into account that Palestine, between 1920 and the mid 1930s, did not have the Jewish community did not have a middle class. So the free market was not really working there. Well, there was no free market, okay, and there was no industry, and there was no middle class. Well, there was, and so they thought, here is the opportunity, because there is no middle class, to build a socialist country. Okay? That's where the workers will be the backbone of the society. And they believed in it very strongly, and they had some very good people, like David Remes, who was her lover, and Ben-Gurion and some others, who basically created the foundations for the Histadrut and for the Labor Party to put down institutions that in Israeli history we call the state in the making, okay? To make a state, to foresee a state way before it was recognized or established. She was a part of it.
Do you think that Golda Meir ever in her heart of hearts accepted the idea of a capitalist, middle class, bourgeois, Jewish state? I think in her heart of hearts, right up until the very end, she really believed the best option for Israel would be an Israel where the Mapai or the Maarach would run everything, where the Histadrut would take care of people, where people who had money would share it with people who were unemployed.
But it was also a vision that many people in her generation and her pedigree shared. This was certainly the vision of all, to take a very immodest personal example, of all the siblings of my late grandparents who came as Halutzim until their 90s, and some of them, I met them when we emigrated, they were still convinced socialists, which was to us incomprehensible after the Soviet experience, as you can well imagine.
Yes, because they were living in a totally different climate and milieu, and they believed in socialism. But they did see capitalism coming. It's not as if they didn't. And they also, from the, when the German immigration came to Palestine in the 30s, you did have a middle class. And you did have, people who came with money and established industry, et cetera, et cetera. And actually, Mapai understood it and started developing programs or projects that will be what they called at the time constructive Zionism, that is collaborating and cooperating with the capitalist sector. And it became more and more prominent as time went by because Jews wanted to make money. And most of the yeshuv was not interested in kibbutz life.
Good. Well, let's get to Golda Meir as a major political figure.
Yes.
So, of course, this is the 40s and early 50s is the beginning of her real glory. She does tremendous fundraising, right, for the would-be state, raising money in America to buy arms, right? She's a founding mother with two other women and among the 24 signatories. And she gets a major, major assignment as minister plenipotentiary, and she goes to Moscow. I just want to amuse you with one little detail. Pnina, I don't know if you've seen this. You saw this. I don't know if, Sam, I don't think you've seen this.
So the Hotel Metropole.
This was sent to me by the executive secretary of the Russian Jewish Congress, Anna Bakshitskaya. This is a plaque that was just a few weeks ago installed in Moscow in the Metropole Hotel where Golda Meir had her rooms as the Israeli ambassador. So this is a plaque which commemorates her time there, but also the place where she physically lived. So I just want you to see that. So let's talk about her time in Moscow, because I think for some of us who work in the field of Soviet history and Jewish history, it's one of the most fascinating periods. So Sam, give us some sense of young Israel's relations with the Soviet Union and sort of the mandate that Golda Meir is given when she goes there.
I don't think she jumped at the chance to go. She wasn't a job that she had her heart set on, but Moshe Sharet said, you go. This was what many Israelis believed to be a plastic moment. That is, that Gromyko had made that very important speech supporting a Jewish state while the United States was embargoing arms. The Soviet Union was allowing the Czechs to send arms. What a lot of people forget is that by allowing Polish Jews in the Soviet Union to repatriate to Poland, this sent perhaps over 150,000 Jews to Israel, and the Soviet Union didn't have to do that. At the time, she understood that there were very many negative signs that were starting. The murder of Mikhail's and so on. Before she got to Moscow.
Exactly. So she gets to Moscow in September, by which point, right, Mikhail's had already been assassinated. Yeah. That's January 1948. So, I mean, the writing is on the wall.
The writing's on the wall, but it wasn't clear just how just how inscribed the writing was. There was this sense that there were possibilities in this relationship. But I think that both Stalin and Golda, Lahavdil, as they say in Yiddish, but both Stalin and Golda were surprised by the reaction of Russian Jews when she got to Moscow.
Yeah, so maybe, Pnina, we could talk about this a little more, and we have some funny slides
yes.
to illustrate it. Funny, I mean, because you see Molotov without a shirt, with his Jewish wife, right.
Polina.
Yes, yeah. So the reaction, which is really a mythological moment to some of us today, although I met many people who remember this as eyewitnesses.
The Molotov,
And also the visit to the synagogue.
To the synagogue, So you want to talk about the Molotov first? Molotov was the Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Soviet Union, and she handed her, her mandate to him. And as she was talking to him, and then his wife came by, this is Polina, and talked to her in Yiddish, Molotov's wife, Molotova, and spoke to her in Yiddish and said that she was a Yiddish tochter. And Golda was very happy, so they started discussing and talking.
A Jewish daughter.
A Jewish girl, yeah. So they had a nice talk. And soon later, Molotova, the wife, was found guilty of something. I don't think it's exactly what she was, convicted of having done, and she was deported to Kazakhstan.
She was herself a very powerful figure.
And as soon as Stalin died, Molotov's first request was to get his wife back.
Yes,
that's right.
So that was a good lesson to Golda. Not to look for Jews. One of the problems was that Golda's mission was trying to reach out to Jews. That's a part of the, they were trying to reach out to Jews, and they had this fantasy that the Jews, who were about 1 million, would come to Palestine. In those days, that was just after the, that was during the War of Independence. And many Arabs either left or were kicked out by the Israelis. And the Jewish community at the time was about 600,000 people. That's all. So in order to survive, they needed people. They were taking a lot of, more than a million immigrants from the eastern countries, from North Africa at the time, but from Iraq, from Yemen. But this was not the manpower that they needed in order to build the state. They had their eyes on Soviet Jewry because Soviet Jewry was very, very educated and very, very skilled. So they were hoping, as they were hoping also in the 90s, that once they come, if they come, they will participate in building the state. So she was very interested in this, both in terms of policy and because of her, Jewish heart. She wanted to connect with Jews, and she didn't want them to be in Soviet Union. She wanted them to come to Palestine. And her mission did is they were trying to get in touch with Jews in many ways. And the Soviet government did not like it. And so they would call Golda and say, you guys are disseminating newsletters, about Israel. This has to stop. We don't mind helping Israel, but we don't want you to get in touch with our Jews. That was the policy.
Yeah. So Sam, when Golda Meir is in Moscow, right, this is the beginning of what is often called the dark years for Soviet Jewry. And in fact, she is there in September 48, right, during the arrests of some members of the anti-fascist Jewish committee. She stays until what?
Until March 49.
So basically the second wave of arrests is about to happen. So these are not exactly, wonderful times for
No, I mean, it's an open question. I mean, there are there are bigger experts on this period than myself, but it's an open question to what degree the scene at the synagogue fueled Stalin's suspicion and paranoia, to what degree it was already beginning. I wonder whether Golda Meir herself was not surprised by the depth of the reaction that she got. Because Soviet Jewry, not the Polish Jews who were exiled there, but Soviet Jewry had been a closed book to the Yeshuv. Even Weizmann's sister wasn't allowed to leave. So I think Golda Meir, she felt that emotional electricity that in Moscow, not in Minsk and not in Vilna, not in Kovno, but in Moscow, they're still Jewish. And I think she had that emotional tie to the cause of Soviet Jewry that she never lost.
So that's the famous picture, right?
That's the only picture that we have from this incident, from its event.
Not 49.
Well, yes, 48, absolutely. The Rosh Hashanah of 48.
Corrected silently.
Yeah. In 49, she's already back in Israel. Yeah. So you see her here, you know, and... surrounded by men, as you see, it's a whole sea of men, and she in the middle. And actually, it would be interesting to see what people think here. Is she smiling? Is she frozen? Is she, you know, what is her expression here? It's quite interesting. I was thinking about it as I was preparing for this talk. I don't know how to think about it, and I think also that she has a fur hat. I know that she got a fur coat before she came to Moscow, and what happened is she decided for the mission to go on Rosh Hashanah to services, and as they were approaching the synagogue, they were totally stunned by the number of people. Okay, there were 50,000 people around the synagogue, and the synagogue was totally packed, and that was the moment when she was absolutely stunned to learn that Jews, Soviet Jews, really cared, you know, that they had a Jewish identity and that they cared about Israel and they wanted to see her. It was a very, very moving moment for her.
Very good.
And
very
then when good. She went back, when she, you know, she could not walk back because there were so many people. So they put her in a cab. And everybody was, you know, people were just surrounding the cab. And... She was totally frozen. She didn't know. She was a very good speaker. She could not find words, and so finally, what she did is she lowered the window, and she said to them in Yiddish. I don't know Yiddish, so I'm not going to repeat it in Yiddish, but she said in English. She said, "Thank you for being Jews or for remaining Jews." So she felt very strongly, as you said, Sam, that you know, this identity did not die. And that it was very important.
Good. Well, I think let's fast forward a little bit because I think we want to get to the 1970s and to certain moments when, you know, her resolve was really tested. But so she has a stellar career, right, as a minister of labor. And I know, Pnina, you are dealing with that in your book,
yes.
Particularly how instrumental she was in Israel's labor legislation, correct?
Very instrumental.
Correct.
And totally instrumental.
Prime Minister, Foreign Minister under Ben-Gurion, and finally she becomes Israel's fourth Prime Minister in 1974.
Yes,
so I did a little bit of checking.
1969.
I did a little bit of checking, and please correct me if this is wrong, but it seems that she was only the sixth female head of state, and also that prior to her, the other five had been in Southeast Asia and the Far East.
Yeah.
And the only major figure was Indira Gandhi. The others were not particularly well known. And also she is prime minister before Margaret Thatcher, for instance, or Isabella Perón. So I'd like to just spend a little bit of time talking about the significance of her being a woman, a major politician, both in Israel and on the international arena.
So the way that it happened is the Six-Day War came, and Eshkol was prime minister. Eshkol had heart problems. And so 2 months after the Six-Day War, or I don't remember exactly, but not 2 months, a few more months later, He passed away. He got a heart attack and he passed away. And the question then became, who is going to take his place? Now, what we have to understand is she was not elected in the way that, you know, Donald Trump was elected or anybody else. This was a party business. So the party had to choose the next prime minister because the election took place a little bit before. And so there were no elections. And the question was, who will the party choose to replace the dead prime minister? There were two contenders, two men who were, you know, very famous generals. One was Moshe Dayan, who was then Minister of Defense, and the other one was Yigal Alon, who was the deputy prime minister, who was a very famous general in the 48 war. So these two military people, you know, that Israelis like military heroes to lead them. And so both of those were contending for the job. And the old party, you know, bosses decided that they don't want either of them because they were too young and they were fighting each other. They were afraid of, you know, too much conflict. They focused on Golda. So they focused on Golda both because they valued her and thought that her foreign affairs experience will be very valuable as prime minister. They were very friendly with her and trusted her. And it was a way to get away from the conflict between the two guys. So that's what they did. Hmm.
So, Sam, maybe you could, she becomes, of course, extremely famous and very famous in America. She meets with President Nixon twice. Yeah. I'm interested in sort of what sometimes is referred to as her vision of peace in the 1970s in the Arab-Israeli conflict. And what do you think she was trying to achieve?
Well, first of all, what's amazing is that just before she became prime minister, she was not on the radar screen to be prime minister. I mean, people.
Exactly.
But then within a very short time, her approval rating went through the charts.
Shot up. Yeah.
So she had, she very quickly won the trust and approval of the Israeli public in her own right. Mm-hmm. In her own right. Now, many historians bitterly criticize her legacy. Because they say if she had accepted Dayan's suggestion that Israel pull back from the Suez Canal in 1971, they could have averted the Yom Kippur War. And the question is, at that time, Sadat made it very clear that any pullback from the Suez Canal had to be linked to an Israeli promise to withdraw from all of Sinai and from the West Bank and from the Golan Heights. So Sadat was willing to accept a temporary pullback, but only as part of a bigger package. And in retrospect, you might say, well, Israel would have, you know, since Israel pulled out of Sinai anyway, they should have done it, and it would have averted the Yom Kippur War. But at the time, what Israeli would have given up the gains of the Six-Day War? Keep in mind that one of the most traumatic experiences in Golda Meir's life, I think, as bad as the pogrom thing, and you might disagree with me, is sitting in the UN in early 1957 and hearing Henry Cabot Lodge, the American ambassador to the UN, openly deceive her, break a promise that he had made to the Israelis that there would be specific guarantees if Israel withdrew from Sinai in 57. And Golda Meir had just been deceived by the ceasefire in 1970, where the U.S. promised that the Egyptians would not move military equipment to the canal, and they immediately moved the missiles. So Golda Meir was not going to withdraw from the Suez Canal for a promise of non-belligerency. And yet she's very much attacked for having allegedly been so narrow-minded and so obstinate that she brought about the Yom Kippur War. And I think it's not fair.
Pnina, would you like to jump in?
Yeah, I think, all of this is true. Maybe people in the audience will have views on this, that we can open a discussion about it. You know, was she sufficiently, flexible or not? You know, it's a question. I think what is important to remember is the public did not want to give away any territory. And she actually was the kind of leader who was more sensitive to her public rather than to a goal in policy, regardless of what the public wants, okay? There are leaders who say, I don't care what the public wants, I know what's good for the public. That's Ben-Gurion used to say that, okay? She didn't feel that way. So she felt that we had this war. The war was forced upon us, the Six-Day War. It was a terrible war. It really, scared us and terrified us. And we have now this great land that protects us, and therefore, we are not going to give it up. Actually, she was not prepared to give up. She said, we're going to give up a little bit here and there, some border corrections, but not more than that. That was her position.
Yeah. So the last years of her service as prime minister were very challenging because
yes.
She had three crises in a row. The first and third are very well known. The first is the terrorist attack against the Israeli heavy lifting team at the Munich Olympics,
yes.
Right? Which she had to handle.
The athletes.
And that's the team incidentally included Soviet immigrants.
Yes.
And it was a very strong team. The second is a lesser known crisis, which also has to do with Soviet Jews. Do you know what I'm referring to?
No.
The so-called Austrian crisis.
Yeah.
Do people know about this?
Kreisky. Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so why don't you talk about it?
Well, I find that it's
very... was just before the Yom Kippur
that's
War.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. She had three in a row. Yeah.
And then the crisis with the Black Panthers and the riots.
That's right. Yeah. So basically, the Austrian crisis, in brief, Bruno Kreisky, who is Austria's prime minister, who himself is a Jew, decides to close a transit facility on the Austrian-Czech border, which was used by immigrants from the Soviet Union who were coming by way of Czechoslovakia. After a small group is taken hostage by Palestinian terrorists, and Golda Meir goes there to broker some sort of resolution. And it was a very challenging moment, right?
Yes.
And it left her very, very bitter about this. And then the Yom Kippur War, which is really... for some, her hour of glory, and for others,
yes.
Not her best hour. So let's talk a little about it, and maybe we can open up the floor.
About the Yom Kippur War itself. Okay,
yeah.
So the Yom Kippur War, first of all, the Israeli intelligence failed to foresee the war coming. That is a fact that is very important to understand. And so we just saw the... I have my research assistant here who got me the protocols. We don't see him here, but the chief of intelligence was saying the day before the war, was saying the probability of war is lower than low. Okay? Nemucha mi nemucha. So, tzvirut nemucha mi nemucha. So they, so she trusted the, her generals. And then the next day, the war started.
That means she was not Russian enough. because a Russian military
leader. She didn't mistrust them as she mistrusted. No, actually, the truth of the matter is, it's more complicated than that because what she insisted on, and there are documents to show that this is true, she was very restless, and she was suspicious. But they kept saying to her, okay, it's okay, and you don't understand anything about security, and we are telling you, everything is going to be okay, and we are all set up to confront and accept a challenge if it comes. They assured her, and she felt that she has to trust, she had no choice. That's the way she felt about it, okay? The next day in the afternoon, the war started at 2:00 in the afternoon, okay? Now, what happened is, the war started, both the Syrian and the Egyptian army were very well trained, got excellent weapons from the Soviet Union, okay, that Israelis didn't even know about, okay, which helped them a great deal, and they were making good progress. As they were making good progress, Moshe Dayan became very upset, okay, And for a, you know, for a few hours, he was panicking. He was panicking, and he was talking about the fall of the Third Temple. You know, so we had two temples, and Israel was the Third Temple. He was talking about this is Chorban Bayit Shlishi, the fall of the Third Temple. And she was just beside herself when she heard it, right? What she understood is that maybe he's just panicked and that he's not in his right mind. And what she did is she started shifting her trust or her the weight of the decision-making process to the chief of staff, who was David Elazar, away from Dayan. Mm-hmm. That was her big moment.
Wow. You know? So, Sam, do you think she was scapegoated? And because, well, you know, her resignation comes very soon after
sure.
that.
Sure. I mean, first of all, she made some really important contributions. One, she learned at 4 a.m. that war would break out that day because of... And she calls a meeting right away. And she makes... And she's instrumental in two key decisions. Before the war breaks out. One, not to launch a preventive strike. The Air Force believed that they could launch a preventive strike either on Syria or on Egypt and save a lot of lives. She said, we're not going to take that chance because we might need the United States. And that, I think that was the right decision. The second is that Dayan and Elazar were arguing about mobilization. And she said, mobilize everybody. I mean, mobilize more rather than fewer, and then when the war started, by and large she was solid. They say that the second or third day she was very depressed, but basically she was solid. She provided solid leadership, and she understood that even though Dado Elazar, the chief of staff, had failed in very key respects before the war. His statement, well, the Syrians have 1,200 tanks on the Golan Heights, but that's maneuvers, but we have 100 tanks. That should do it, right? I mean, but once the war started, she did not fire him. She did not accept Dayan's offer to resign. She provided that steady leadership, which was so necessary. Was she scapegoated? Look, it was on her watch. It was a terrible disaster. It was a terrible intelligence failure. And in a democracy, the prime minister has to bear responsibility, even though the Agranat Commission said that she and Dayan were not directly responsible. Both should have resigned.
Good.
I just want to say one word, and that is, in Hebrew, we don't have a term like accountability. You will be very surprised to learn, okay? Now, we talk about accountability in constitutional law and in political theory. We don't have the term, okay, which is very interesting. I don't know if you have it in Russian. Accountability.
Yes, отчетность.
Not responsibility.
Ответственность.
И отчетность, yes.
Okay, so we don't have it. Somehow we didn't translate it either from the Russian or from the English or from the German.
Not ахрают.
Rayut is responsibility, is not accountability.
I think the difference is subtle but significant.
It's subtle but very important. So she, so as you said, she was accountable. She was the prime minister. It happened on her watch. The army was not prepared. The intelligence did not do a good job. And, you know, as the Truman said, the buck stops, you know, in the White House, that's where it is. And it was difficult for her to accept it because what she saw is that she turned around a very, very bad military situation into a good situation. Okay?
Wonderful.
And she thought that she should be rewarded for that.
Yes, we are unfortunately out of time. And I want to thank Sam Kassow and Pnina Lahav for this really rewarding conversation. I want to thank you all for being here and invite you back in November when we celebrate Vasily Grossman's legacy. And thanks again.
Thank you. Thank you.